So let's look at the nature of the instruction booklet in our Lego toolkit that builds our bodies. And everybody knows now that this is DNA, our genetic code. And it's just kind of amazing how all this works. You have four different base pair types, right? G, C, T, A. So molecularly, this is what they look like. And T's pair with A's. And C's pair with G's. And so these pairs are kind of on either side of the spiral helix shape. And so the basic instruction is just basically that kind of TA pair or the CG pair. And out of that, you build combinations. And it's really an amazing demonstration of the power of combinations, combinatorial explosion, how much information you can encode using these very, very simple basic instructions. A sequence of three of these base pairs can determine essentially an amino acid that is the building block of proteins. And proteins really are the level of these building blocks. So even lower than the level of the cells that we talked about is this kind of protein level. And that's really where the instruction booklet is. So if you really want to make the analogy, one Lego brick is one amino acid, which is the basic element. So you have cells composed of all these proteins, and you build up the individual cells like that as well. So you just keep going up the levels here. You've got base pair, three of those equals an amino acid, and then a entire protein is a sequence of amino acids, which is about typically between 300 to 900 base pairs in length. Now, one thing that's interesting is that genes typically have about 27,000 base pairs. And so there's a lot of extra stuff going on. And this extra stuff we'll see is a recurring theme that a lot of, if you think about this from the Lego perspective, a lot of the instructions are not just like which block, but really about where to put that block, and in particular, when to put that block. And those little things that say like 2x, 3x, keep doing this thing over and over again, those kinds of things have a lot of power, right? If you keep building the same parts over and over again, then that can really kind of multiply the expressiveness, the power of the kind of instruction booklet, without having to specify each thing over and over again. And these regulatory parts of the gene are playing an important role here. So genes have much more than just proteins. Proteins are really kind of the basic element, but it's much more than just the proteins. An allele is just how any of these base pairs may differ across a gene. So one allele versus another just basically means a different variant of this sequence, this genetic sequence in a particular gene. And here's this point that only 1.5% of the human DNA codes for proteins. A tiny percent of it is these basic building blocks. Overall, in terms of quantity, that's about 20,000 different types of protein. And this is actually very consistent across most forms of life. We don't really differ, just like those Lego constructions. There's not really a very big difference in the nature of the basic building blocks. And again, this is why we can see, you know, fish turning into humans eventually, is just because it is all the same blocks. And that's really the point here. And what gets more and more elaborated in the DNA, and what differs, again, are all these high-level kind of control sequences that tell us, okay, here's where you put these blocks to make this particular human brain as opposed to the fish brain, right? I mean, that's what's really critical, not the level of the basic proteins. So originally they started describing this this DNA as kind of like junk DNA, but I think now people are understanding that this is where a lot of the action is in regulating and controlling, and it's just like a computer program and gives you this kind of expressive power. All the power in a computer program really comes from those kind of control sequences, the if-thens, the for, while loops, etc. Those allow you to compactly express very powerful, complex coding algorithms. there's been an incredible amount of progress in understanding how this genetic code works, how it plays out over time. And really, as we said, you can't really understand what genes do until you understand the developmental process. And that's kind of this very strong interconnection between genetics and development. Genetics is really expressed and played out in the context of how the body is built. That's the most important thing that the genes specify, is how that kind of fundamental developmental process of building the body takes place. Of course, they also play a role in controlling everything once the body is built, but the most important thing to understand, you know, how this instruction booklet works is really that developmental process. And that developmental process is super complicated. It's like one of the areas where science kind of lags behind the most. We don't really understand all the details about how development works. And so until we do that, we really won't understand how all the genetic code works. But those two, kind of that interplay between genes and development, is really a huge frontier. So we understand the basics, but we don't understand a lot of the details about how it plays out. We do understand how the genetic code gets translated from DNA into RNA, and then the RNA is in the ribosome is this process of kind of actually translating the sequence coded in the genetic code into the construction of these blocks, these proteins. So that process is very well understood. So now that we can actually sequence the genome, we can actually understand exactly the full sequence of every base pair in the human DNA and that of other animals. We now know that, for example, chimpanzees and people share 98.8% of those base pairs are in common. Okay, so we are incredibly closely related to our nearest primate relatives in the great family tree. And so that's staggering, right? I mean, that's like, wow, we are really, really close. There's only 1.2% difference there. Furthermore, as we've said, that the proteins are really the same, and that's true really across the animal kingdom. But these critical kind of regulatory slash junk areas are the ones that do differ. And they differ by 5%. So that's actually, when you concentrate down and you look at the specific aspect of variance, that it there is a reasonable amount of difference there that's controlling all the different kind of morphology between chimpanzees and humans. Okay, and we'll look in a second at the differences between people, which are even tinier.